Hello, hello, everybody. It is 10:06 p.m. Central Time on the 23rd of December 2017 here in the United States, and overseas it is already December 24th, nearing December 25th. So you guys, if you celebrate the holiday, Merry Christmas, and it's Christmas Eve for a lot of people overseas, and it's going to be going into Christmas Eve here in the States. So, yeah, check it out. As if Mother Nature is telling us something, or maybe Harp up in Alaska is telling us something. A 5.0 earthquake up here at the North Pole, at our letter X on the Gackle Ridge, next to Mount Dutch Supervolcano, which is 60 miles long, 30 miles wide, the same size as Toba Supervolcano down in Indonesia. But this one is up here below the North Pole, up at the North Mid-Atlantic Ridge, where the North Mid-Atlantic Ridge starts. That's where Mount Dutch Supervolcano is. And then right next to it, we have R4, which is pretty much right off from the exact physical North Pole. And so 5.0 earthquake up there, indicating pressure is great. We only see North Pole earthquakes when there's a lot of pressure in the Pacific and coming across. Now, there's been big eruptions up here in the North Pacific going into the Arctic Circle. That's up in Kamchatka's Peninsula in Russia, here in eastern Russia. And big blast, 50,000 foot high. Now, last night, didn't do an update. Had a lot going on. Not going to talk about that now. But next to Kamchatka, new swarm activity yesterday. If you missed my update earlier today, you can go over to my YouTube channel and watch it. But I'll just quickly recap. Throughout the day, yesterday and today, a series of 5.0 earthquakes started to develop across the West Pacific, all in our warn zones. And we went over this earlier today. Each fulcrum point was hit by two magnitudes less here and here, where we're looking for 7.0 activity to develop by tomorrow night. Both middle points have been hit today by fives. Check them both off the list just for fulcrum points to be hit. And then up to the north in Japan, also on the Izu Ridge, new 5.0 last night. Up here in Alaska last night, a new 5.0. And we'll talk about what that's going to be causing in the United States in just a little bit. How about a new deep earthquake just north of New Zealand in the 4 range, upper 4, 4.7 in the Kermadec Islands. And it had been all week without any activity in the Kermadecs. We're going on 5 days without any earthquakes. Now, since there's a deep earthquake at 400 kilometers, we have to warn for a 5.7 earthquake. I don't think it'll go all the way up to 6.7. There is a slight, and I mean slight, I'd say probably less than a 10% chance, if I were to put a percentage on it, less than 10% chance that this could cause a 6.7 earthquake. You have a much higher chance, and we'll put it at more like an 80% chance, of up to a 5.7 to develop off this 4.7, where, unfortunately, it puts us on the North Island of New Zealand. Also, to the south, eventually, here in just a little bit, but we have a stair-step action going on right now, so we have to look at this from the side in order for you to see this stair-stepping action that I'm talking about here, where we have our deep earthquake raised high off the globe. Then halfway right on the North Island, about halfway, you see that the earthquakes are stacked up halfway. Well, that's going towards the surface. And then at the south part of the island, we're right at the surface at about a 10-kilometer depth. So it's going from 10 kilometers here all the way down to about, well, almost about 400 kilometers just north of the island. Now, we go back a couple days, and there's our other deep earthquake on the south part of the island. But we need to get that off there because it's been just a minute since it struck. All that being said, for my people in New Zealand, we're going to watch the North Island from Wellington up to Auckland, which basically encompasses the North Island entirely, for a new up to 5.7 earthquake within 72 hours from today, based upon the new deep earthquake that just struck at the catcher's mitt position, just north of it, right here. Okay? Over to the west, this 5.0 earthquake is right on at 200 kilometers deep. Now again, like I told you, deep earthquakes can cause shallower, larger earthquakes, 1 to 2 magnitudes larger. If this 5 were to hold true and go all the way up to a 7, we're looking for 7s here where the 5 is and here where this 5 is. It had been fully almost a week since any activity had struck in either location. Now today, they're checked off with 5s, even though they're spot on in the locations, even though they're spot on in the time. Since they're 2 magnitudes less than expected, they are misses for me. I consider anything 1 magnitude or less within 200 miles, down to the days where we warn, hits. And if they're if they're more than 2 magnitudes off, then, or 1 magnitude, again, that's what I'm looking for. If it's more than that, I consider that a miss. So it's really troubling for me to see this because I'm looking into tomorrow for the forecast. And if it doesn't hit by tomorrow, well, we're really scratching my head, figuring out where this energy is going from all the deep quakes. Now, in the past, it's taken 7 to 10 days. I issue 7-day forecasts. So we'll get into that by the end of this broadcast. We'll talk about time frames on the deep earthquakes. Another deep earthquake struck over here next to Bali, Indonesia, technically in East Timor. So East Timor's right there. This is Indonesia. So it's right next to East Timor. Almost 5.0 activity. And we were looking for 5.0 activity to strike next to each volcano, including Mount Agung, which is right here in Bali. So right next to it, we get a new deep earthquake, 4.6. So how many is that? That's 3 right there. You see, 3 deep earthquakes in the past day just across the far west Pacific. Going up towards Japan, another deep earthquake, 277 kilometers deep, 4.5. You starting to see something here? Multiple deep earthquakes since yesterday. In the last 24 hours, multiple deep quakes, meaning that our deep earthquake event is carrying on. Up here, like I said, next to Kamchatka's peninsula, new 5.0 activity developed. That's also next to Ebiko volcano in the Kuril Islands. But we're actually coming in on the underside. We're on 5.5 total energy. It could go up to 6 to 6.5. here at this location. Like I said, it could go pretty big at this spot. So far, 5.5, that's not that big. I mean, comparatively. I mean, it's big enough. We've seen fatalities on those size earthquakes, but there's nobody that lives there. Over to the east, new 5.0 activity in the Aleutian Island Chain, 4.8. And like I said, a 5 struck up here in North Canada, Yukon Territory, northern edge of the North American Craton. Quickly, let's jump over to Europe. Over here from the Middle East, let's start in Asia and go over to Europe. Starting next to Smith Island. Yes, Smith Island. How do I know the name of this island here? I had to go look it up for the forecast for this week. This actually belongs to India. And I didn't know the name of it, so I went to go look it up, and I thought it would be some kind of Indian name, and there it is, Smith Island. Well, it got hit with a new 5.3 earthquake yesterday. Check it off the list. Yes, it was on the list for this week. Up to the north. All across Myanmar, 4.6 and 4.3. That's all today. Pressure coming off the 5.3. So really, what's happening? The 5.3 is pushed to the west-northwest and has displaced Myanmar. Over to the west from there, we have a silent zone, which I think is pretty obvious. This is Nepal. We would look to the middle of Nepal, between India. Of course, this is only about 150 miles across. India into China, and that's Nepal. Right across the middle, the fulcrum point. We don't just look all across this entire area. We only look to the middle point, the fulcrum, between the two sets of quakes here. Okay, and we add these together, 4.6 plus 4.3 equals 4.7. Add in the 4.1 and we're at 4.8. So let's put it at a 4.8 to 5.0 earthquake striking right in the middle fulcrum point within the next 72 hours. Over to the west, Iran, you've been hit exactly as expected all week long. Now you have a new swarm on your south plate boundary. What's going on here is your plate boundaries are in flux, both north and south. Look at where the earthquake struck. First the north, up near Tehran, then to the middle, right at the center point where we issued our warning, now to the south. And if this holds true, we'll probably tilt back to the north here. We'll see the center hit, and then the north hit again. So it's bouncing back and forth between our two arrows. These are plate boundaries between the Iranian plate, Eurasia, and Saudi Arabia. And yes, that's the Iranian plate. I had to look it up too. I was like, what's the name of the plate? Oh, it's the Iranian plate. Over to the west, we have Turkey. And Turkey contends and carries the pressure over to the west. So, in other words, it pushes and then carries the pressure into the Aegean Sea, out of Iran. Up to the west-northwest, look what happened today. Or west-northwest from Turkey, I should say. Look what happened today. 3.2 earthquake striking in eastern Romania. Additionally, a 3.0 earthquake striking in south Italy, and a 3.0 earthquake, mid-range 3, striking over at the Strait of Gibraltar in south Spain, north of Morocco. All same-sized earthquakes, all within the last day, and this is expected. We normally see pressure transfer across Europe coming out of Turkey. Well, where did it push? Actually, between the Black Sea and Caspian Sea, there was a 4. But this has been way less this week than we were expecting. The highest we went was 4.9, and we were looking to go up to 5.9, maybe even to 6. I was looking for a 6 in Greece, and instead we get a 5. Is that all she wrote? I don't think so. It's still trapped in Iran. We were talking about this in my update earlier today. It's so obvious. The pressure was remained and has remained across central Iran going over to the west. It's been bottlenecked there and has not flowed out. Again, the 4.9 was the biggest earthquake of the week for South Europe entirely in the Mediterranean, and that's way less than normal with what's going on around the rest of the planet. So eventually, in the next few days, it's not going to be, it's not one of these Discovery Channels, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. It's not one of those, and it's not one of these USGS, oh, a matter of 50 years, 10% or chance of less. We're talking about in the next few days, the pressure that's been built and expended across Iran is going to be released into Turkey, going into Greece. And this is kind of reminding me of where we were a year and a half ago, when Greece was swarming and it held back the pressure from Italy. So what I think is going to happen here will be a very large earthquake striking between Greece and Turkey in the next several days, probably right past Christmas, but before New Year's, as all the pressure in Iran is released like a dam breaking and the water all flowing out at once. Then there'll be a giant push across Europe. It'll excite all of Europe. You'll see all of our warn locations get hit. But we have a new forecast getting ready to come out tomorrow night, Sunday night. So we have a new forecast that issues for this week. Central America, South America, look at you. We told you it was going to happen, and now it has. Pressure has transferred across the plate boundaries, or the plate fractures, I should say. There are fracture zones that extend east to west. They look like rungs on a ladder or latitude on the map. And pressure transfers across these zones. And when we get earthquakes out here in the middle, north of Easter Island and south of Easter Island, I've likened this in the past to a train going over a trestle and vibrating the whole bridge as it goes over the giant train trestle. So the pressure transferring across this zone causes vibrations, which cause earthquakes. But I want you to differentiate this seismic pressure that's transferring across the regions from the earthquakes themselves. So it's not one earthquake causing another earthquake 2,000 miles away. It is seismic pressure, quote-unquote, causing both earthquakes across the huge distance. And where's the seismic pressure coming from? It's coming up from down below the plate, pushing up on the underside. So as it does, it displaces the fracture zones, which then carry the pressure across, and we get earthquakes striking across the way. And the greater the pressure is back here, the greater the pressure is that arrives in South America. And that happened this week. Mexico went up into fives and swarms of fours, and we went up across fours all the way across Central America next to each volcano. So Fuego Volcano, Nevados del Ruiz, Popocatépetl, down here to the south at Reventador, Sabancaya, and Nevados del Chilean. And I mean right next to each one. So 4.9, 4.9, 4.6, 4.6, let's see, 4.6, 4.7, and 5.0. All right next to each volcano. I mean, we warned for fives next to each volcano, and we got within 0.4 on each one. Now, I don't forecast for volcanoes, but I do forecast for earthquakes related to those volcanoes after they're done erupting. You got to understand, each volcano inflates, erupts, then deflates, and then re-inflates almost immediately as the one set of magma is displaced, the chamber refills from down below. And when that happens, it puts these plate boundaries where the Pacific plate meets North America, South America, Central America, puts these regions into flux. It puts them into motion. as those areas inflate and deflate. You get a whole bunch of them going all at once, and it causes major movement. No duh, right? I mean, everybody can understand that. That's what's happening. Okay? And we got new deep earthquakes pushing up from down below, pushing over to the east, meaning in the next few days, since we just got a new 4.6, 4.7 earthquake out here, meaning in the next 1 to 2 days, Colombia is about to get hit again with earthquakes larger than the 4.6 and 4.7. This is like a train going across the bridge, and at the end of the bridge, there's a giant mountain it's going to hit. Not a brick wall. I mean, I'm talking a giant mountain. It will displace the train. And that's what's going to happen. The pressure is going to come in. It's going to hit South America, and it's going to displace the pressure up and around. It's going to seek a path of least resistance. And we'll see a set of fives, one here on the west coast of South America, Colombia, the other over to the east in the eastern Caribbean. Hey, for my eastern Caribbean viewers, guys, there's a lot of people that live down here. Barbados, Montenegro, all the beautiful islands, St. Lucia, all those islands down there. Well, we have to warn the southern tip north of Venezuela. No bueno, right? Okay, I can say that, right? Yeah, that's the only Spanish I know. Not good. You're looking for 5.0 activity right after Christmas by like December 27th at the latest as this all comes in. South America, same thing. When you're looking down at Chile, you're looking from Christmas Day to December 27th, and you guys are going to be getting hit by an incoming round of pressure in the 5 range as well. But you're used to that. I hope I got this right. If I'm off by even a magnitude, it'll make a big difference. Like, let's say I'm warning for 5s and 6s hit. Now, I want you to have a plan for one magnitude larger just in case I'm lowballing it, or they are. For instance, what if this is a 5.5 out here? The other one was. What if this one was? What if they're lowballing that by magnitude? They do that a lot. So let's say that was a 5. That would affect my forecast downstream. You got to understand, this is upstream. This is downstream. Look where the arrows point. And the pressure flows, this seismic pressure that I'm talking about, that causes the earthquakes, this seismic pressure flows like a fluid. Now that gets us into North America, flowing like a fluid. Look at the Midwest. Look what happened in the New Madrid seismic zone and down to the south over the past few days down in Alabama. All the same sized earthquakes, 2.5, 2.7, coming out of the Midwest at the fracking ops. And they're striking right along our red arrows. Why is that? Pressure transfers across the plate. Now I'm going to show you the last 24 hours worth of USGS reported 0.0 and greater earthquakes. You know, actually, hold on. Before we do that, let's go look at the last 7 days of 0.0 and greater earthquakes. So now you'll really understand. And I'm going to turn on a display capture so you can see what I see. And here we go. And we'll look at this. Here's the last 7 days. Now you might say, okay, there's a lot of numbers on there. So just get a look at the rings. The rings kind of tell us the size of the earthquakes. The number of rings there are equal the size of the quake. So you see this one up here in like New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, 2.0. It's got 2 rings. And then you've got another two, and it's got 2 rings. Then you get to threes here, and the threes have 3 rings, and fours have 4 rings. Pretty obvious. So I'm going to turn off the magnitudes, and we'll just turn these rings down a little bit so you can see. Now, do you see how it comes across southern Colorado and western Texas? How the earthquakes come across? And then they bottleneck at Oklahoma, go across Arkansas and the New Madrid seismic zone in Missouri, and then take a dip down to the south, and then follow a line east-northeast along the eastern seaboard going up to the east-northeast. I mean, it's pretty obvious, right? So this is in the course of 7 days. And on the west coast, I mean, it's so much, and this is normal. This is actually normal. But you'll see a ring of quakes with more of a silent area right at the middle. Well, the ring of quakes touches up to Yellowstone, where the northwestern edge of the craton is. Now, a great amount of pressure comes in from the west coast. As it does, it causes earthquakes over here on the west coast, obviously. Then pressure goes over to the east, it hits the edge of the craton, and then it follows the contours of the interior portion of the plate up across to the east coast. 4.0 earthquakes on the west coast cause 4.0 earthquakes in the Midwest. And again, it's not the... let me rephrase that, because again, there's people that are picking apart what I'm saying. I don't want to, you know, again, like cause any confusion on this. A 4.0 that's caused on the West Coast can be caused also in the Midwest by this seismic pressure that transfers across the plates. It's not that a 4.0 up in Vancouver Island is somehow causing a 4.0 earthquake down in Oklahoma, that's an impossibility. There's just not enough force involved with a 4.2 here to cause a 4.0 here, and that's a main contention that one of the professionals who's been dogging me is maintaining, and I understand that. However, nonetheless, a 4.2 earthquake is striking here, and then the next day to 2 days later, we get a 4.0 earthquake striking here on a regular basis. So there's some other factor playing in that's aiding in this pressure transferring across the plate and causing similar sized earthquakes within days. And I firmly now think I've established at this point that the seismic pressure that's transferring is transferring along the contours and the undersides of all the plates, and then transferring up through the plates to a shallow depth. And unfortunately, the Midwest stands prone because humans have stepped in and created man-made perforations like drill points in a tooth, and you apply pressure to that tooth, and in this case it's a multi-layer plate, but the same thing happens. Fracturing. Unintended fracturing that's aiding the pressure and transferring across the edge of the plate. Otherwise, it would diffuse out by the time it reaches the Midwest, and it would get trapped in the New Madrid seismic zone bend of that plate, and over time, it would build over hundreds of years into a single large earthquake in the Midwest, and would get one of our big Midwest earthquakes at the New Madrid. But now, the seismic pressure is being robbed, or let's just call it, it's being precipitated. It's being man-made precipitated. It is drilled in here. There are pressure release valves, human drill points. And that's what's going on. So when pressure starts on the West Coast, it goes to the East Coast in a matter of days. Now that you understand that, let's go look at the last 24 hours worth of earthquakes, because there's something else I need to show you that's pretty significant going on the West Coast right now. So over the last 24 hours, we've been looking at it for the last several weeks, the Anza Gap slow slip down in Southern California. And the only difference today is that it's spread out, starting down at Salton Sea Volcano at the border with Mexico and going up past Anza Gap at Riverside, where new fires have broken out suddenly. Going up east of LA, east of the LA Basin, and then breaking off, going up to Little Lake, California at Volcano Peak, and going up to the west northwest in South San Joaquin Valley at Colinga, next to the Colinga pumping operations, oil and gas. So over here, we have volcanoes. Do I need to show them to you? People like to look at them. Of course, you know, some people don't like to take a YouTuber's word for anything. I don't blame you. With everything that's on YouTube, I don't blame you. That's why I show everything every time, because you don't trust YouTubers, most YouTubers, more than you can throw them, and you can't throw them anywhere, so don't trust them at all, right? So let me show you. Taking a look at the screen. We'll zoom in. Let me get the coordinates from the USGS first. We'll start with the 1.2 kind of right in the middle here. See, it says Little Lake, California. There is a little lake there. There indeed is a little lake. But there's something else there that I think will draw your attention a little bit more than the little lake. They should rename the area, because really what's there is Volcano Central. Look at this. So see all these black lava flows? Let me bring it in at a different, steeper of an angle there. There we go. There's Volcano Peak. Each one of these is like an obsidian dome rising. Then we also have cinder cones here, sills that have flowed off the sides, so many of them, and then several where they formed on top of each other, like 1, 2, 3, 4, another couple there. Then also we have the Coso Volcanic Field right here, and that's marked by the Smithsonian. And inside the Coso Field, they've drilled into the upper reaches of the magma chamber and are steaming off. Of course, they're pumping in water to do this. Pumping in water and then steaming it off to turn turbines. And they call this Devil's Kitchen. Interesting, right? As we look at it, it's a swarm. Over to the west, here, this 2.3. Get the coordinates on that. Central California, listed by the EMSC. Their information comes from the USGS NEIC, though. Makes you wonder why the USGS doesn't have this on their feeds, guys. Don't worry. I'll show you what's there. There's a reason why they sometimes hide the earthquakes at these locations. First of all, we'll zoom in and you'll see we've got some farmers' fields. But mixed in with the farmers' fields, starting here, we have an oil and gas pumping operation. And look at the size of it. and will go over to the west-northwest, and it really picks up. So it's back, nestled back up here into the hillside, and it took me a while to identify some of these areas. But, I mean, here, let me just show you. There's no place marks you can download to get these. You have to actually go do your own sleuthing to find them. I'm sure there's others nearby, but I'm positive the ones down in the field, down to the east-northeast are, because a viewer sent me pistachios that are also collected from this nearby location where they have all the oil pumping mixed in with. And this is not for farming, guys. This is not water irrigation for farming. That's oil and gas. And there's a lot up here. Here, let me wait. Where are we? There's a lot right in here going up to here where I'm not exaggerating when I say a lot. Let me zoom in and show you. They look like little ants on the ground from this point, but I'll zoom in a little bit more. There we go. You can see the wells. So that kind of gives you a size of the operation here, and it just goes on and on and on to the north. Keeps going and going, right? And yeah, that's not quarrying. These aren't for quarries. This is all oil and gas. And it goes down to the south, following it all the way down to the tip of Bakersfield, where there's even more. And we, I think, have some marked in here. Let's see, where did I mark them? Ah, right here. So you'll see the pumping operations here, and then they extend right across the road, or across the quarry, and go into the farmers' fields. And just keep going. They follow the line of oil and gas that exist out there. I guess they, you know, deem that safe for food consumption. As we go over to the west, the creeping section of the San Andreas South Hayward Fault 3.3 earthquake. It's starting to pick up in magnitudes. Now that you understand what's going on, I just showed you the volcanoes, I just showed you the pumping operations, and I just told you that the Riverside Anzagap slow slip is picking up, and the whole San Andreas, South San Andreas, has moved from Salton Sea up to Santa Barbara. There's one silent zone where all the fires happened. We have one more day to go in our warning location. California still has not been hit. We're looking for a 6.0 earthquake to strike up here to the west-northwest off the coast of Eureka, followed by a new 5.0 type earthquake to strike down in Southern California. Still has not happened. But we have one day to go, and we have something else going on. Let me show you. Let's go over to the real-time tremor map from the University of Washington State and look over the last 48 hours since I didn't do my update last night. Look at this. You see how long that took to populate? Again, here, let's look at 3 hours. Here's 3 hours. Now look at 48. Look how long this takes to populate. Thousands of events have now developed. Thousands of tremors in South Oregon, North Oregon, Southwest Washington, and Northwest California. There's diagonal lines connecting between the zones in California going down to Redding. And then there's a silent zone between north of Grants Pass and Eugene, then picking up north of Salem, south of Portland, going into downtown Portland, and south of Olympia. A few spattering of little vibrations, little small tremors up in South Vancouver Island near Victoria. What does this all mean? Well, you have to take into account the swarm down here in California, down in Southern California, and the connecting swarms going up to the north, which I haven't even really talked about. Guys, how about this? Look at this right here. A dying out of the swarm at geysers, but a picking up in earthquakes going up to near 3.0 at Eureka. Connect it through up to the north, and where does this take us? It takes us right back into this. So really, you have to imagine a bunch of little red dots down in Southern California, up at California-Nevada's border, over to the west-northwest at geysers, and then right here. Of course, we can see them. All this means is that the whole North American plate is slow slipping right now, not just at Anzagap. Oregon, Washington, California, all moving, all at once, all on land, thousands of tremors at this point. Thousands. It's not even up for debate. You can see them on the map here. I can just scroll down the list, look how many, and there's, I think, 40 per click, and then this tops out. and we go back to yesterday and the day before, and we're getting in, well, I think somebody else did a count in the thousands. I think we're at 2,000 for the last 3 days or something. It's insane. So we've really picked up. Now look at this. They're capable of reporting these off the coast. I told you, some people were saying, oh, they can't detect tremors off the coast. Yes, they can. We've seen them report them multiple times, even much further out to sea. So now we're getting little vibrations off the coast to the west of Salem. At this point, I think we should go look that up just to see what's there, because I already know what's there, but it's the Cascadia subduction zone. It's not the Juan de Fuca fracture zone. It's the Cascadia subduction zone itself. And this actually is the spot where I think they've done multiple documentaries where some kind of wave was generated out here that then came inland and deposited a bunch of stuff in your seabeds, and they've determined the age on it. Okay, well, that may be the same location, almost down to the point. We're not looking for a megaquake to happen right now. We're going to look for compensation movement to happen out to sea, equal to the numbers of thousands of small events that are happening now and over the past several weeks. And that's starting to add up on its own, which is why I've issued the warning for a 6.0 earthquake in light of the volcanic activity that's happening out here. If you miss the volcanic plume that happened on December 10th, 13 days ago, almost 2 weeks ago, a volcanic plume popped up out of the sea out here. Very quickly, very suddenly, looked like some steam event of some kind, and that's a sign of volcanic activity off the west coast. I'm looking for 6.0 activity right now. However, listen, when this stops, when these go away, and we see none on the list, when you see this list go down to next to nothing or nothing for a few days' time, I will be back on here waving my hands around. I'll probably even turn the camera on. I'll be waving my hands around, trying to get your attention, telling you to watch out for a megaquake. And when I say megaquake, I'm talking about earthquakes above 7.5, up into the 8 range, maybe even larger, as a result of this continental-wide slow slip. We have to put this in perspective, size-wise. What's going on right now? Southern California, Central California, Northern California, Oregon, and Washington going into South Vancouver, 1,300 miles. To put it in perspective for other slow slips, let's go over to Japan before the big megaquake back in 2011, where a slow slip was happening here just south of, south of Tokyo, and then creeping up along to the east, northeast, along the eastern coast of Japan, up to the megaquake location. And that's overall about maybe 500 miles. Maybe a 500-mile slow slip. Down to the south, down in New Zealand, another spot where there was a slow slip going on. Down here on the plate boundary, here between the North Island and the South Island. That was going on for a while, and there's another one going on right now off the eastern coast of Northern Island of New Zealand, where they're looking for a megaquake to eventually develop. But those sections where megaquakes are developing in, like, Japan and down in New Zealand, or another one over here in Italy, there was a slow slip that was happening on the plate boundary going down to Greece right before the big one hit. And that was in the 7 range, right? And Japan was in the 9 range, right? And New Zealand was in the upper 7, almost low 8 range, right? Well, if this is way bigger of an area, and there's thousands more events, small little vibrations that are happening here, if there's more in frequency, that is the number of events, and there's more in area, the size of the movement, then it stands to reason the overall power that's released will be greater than what's happened at the other slow slip locations that are smaller and went for less time. This is going almost as long as the Japan slow slip that led to the megaquake, the 9.0. So will it be a large earthquake? According to the professionals, yes. They say when this goes, it will be the largest earthquake most likely on the planet in many, many years, if not ever, recorded. And if that's the case, then we're looking at 9.0 activity. I'm not saying that's going to happen now. I'm saying that's going to happen when this stops. Now, the professionals have already said in their articles released on October 25th, just a couple of weeks ago or a month and a half ago, down here in California, that the ANSA Gap slow slip at next to Riverside, They said slow slips lead to shallow, large, very large earthquakes on shallow faults nearby the slow slip. And they're just talking about this localized location here at Anzagap Riverside. If that's the case, just with a localized location, what do we do when the whole plate is moving? Somebody needs to talk about this aside from me. This is the elephant in the room. I mean, what does it take? I mean, what is it going to take for professionals to come out of their shells and publicly speak about these things? This has been going on for how long now? Over a week, this has been happening, where these huge clusters of red tremors are all over the map, and no one, not a word, hush, hush. And volcanic activity happening off the coast. The largest volcanic blast in years for the planet just happened this week, and hush, hush on that, too. No news articles, but just a one and maybe 20,000 views on my video. That is insane for the largest blast in years on the planet. There's something going on the west coast of the United States, and you need to be prepared just in case. Now that you understand all the physics behind this, so the plate is moving on land, something's pushing it out to sea. Something out to sea right now is pushing the land. Does that make sense? Where it's quiet now, there's something pushing land, causing activity. There's a greater force out to sea right now, and I believe that's building into 6.0 activity based upon what's happening around the rest of the plate. We're all at fives everywhere. So I want you to have a plan for up to six, just in case we're lowballing it. What time is it now? The time is 10:43 p.m. I think that's a pretty good recap of what's happened so far today. Class is not dismissed yet. Let me tell you really quick, if you're new here, I need you to subscribe to my channel. I'm trying to grow it. Please feel free and confident to share it with your friends, family, loved ones, coworkers. If I name an area and it doesn't hit, I get back on egg on my face every time. And if it hits, I get back on and tell you, and I never get any credit. So either way, I'm going to be back on here telling you whether or not it hits or misses. And I want you to know I take the warnings very serious. I have people that live in most of these areas where I'm warning, even in some of the rural locations, like up here in Yukon Territory. We've got viewers that have written me, and I appreciate them writing me, and I take it serious when I warn them. And I take it serious when I warn you, too. I know this is on YouTube, but where else am I going to do it? I've got to reach the world. Can't do it on my website. You know what kind of bandwidth it takes to reach the world? Anyways, you guys need to subscribe if you're new. Please, trying to grow the channel. And finally, if you like what I do, really, really like what I do, there is a link down below to Patreon where there's several hundred people, nearing 600 people who are doing this. And Patreon is like a dollar. Some people do $5 or more. You can do whatever you want, but this is on a monthly basis if you want. And it adds up. So you get hundreds of people doing a dollar. It's something that offsets if YouTube shuts me off or, like they've been doing recently, marking my videos as not advertiser friendly so I don't get paid for doing my work. My videos here, they're saying they're controversial. Can you believe that? It's really insane if you think about it that people have a problem with me warning you and telling you areas that I think are going to be hit next. And I justify it and give you reasoning behind why I think each area is going to be hit next. So I'm not just waving a crystal ball and just warning hundreds of areas around the planet. We get it down to fine points between areas. We're down to the last day of the forecast. If you want to go watch the forecast from this past Sunday, you're welcome to go watch. Most of the locations have been hit as expected. California, not hit. Japan, hit as expected. We're looking for one spot to go. One spot. But so far, we've already seen almost a six released off the Izu Ridge. We saw, Kyushu? Kyushu was hit. We saw Smith Island get hit. Iran was hit. Eastern Europe was hit. We have not seen the earthquake in South Europe yet. This might be a four-location miss this week, which would take me into the 70 to 75 percentile bracket for this week. I went down to, you know, a B minus in my forecast for this week, maybe even a C. But we have another day to go. I shouldn't grade myself yet. I should wait to the end because many longtime viewers, hey, if you're in chat, here's something we can all get involved with. How many times, and I'll just let you guess, I mean, if you're a longtime viewer, how many times since you've been here have I canceled a warning or gotten to the end of the 7-day warning and then day 8 it hits? Right? Like, I put an artificial 7-day time frame on these warnings because I don't want you to have to look for more than a week. I don't want to be issuing these broad-ended forecasts like the USGS does. You have a 50% chance in the next 100 years for a large earthquake to strike. What good is that kind of... And when I read them, I laugh every time because it's always something long-winded, like they're long-term like that too. It's long-winded and long-term, so it's like, the overall percentage bracket of the overall blah, 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 is 50 years to 10,000 years in the next 52 seconds. And you're like, what the hell does that even mean? So, there we go. Have a plan. Do you have an earthquake plan? Yes? No? Maybe so? Have you ever thought about it? You probably should just give it a think through. What are you going to do if an earthquake strikes? And if it's a small earthquake, let's say it's a 2 or a 3, it'll be the vibrations, it'll be a little bit of shaking, your windows might shake, you might hear a rattle, and it's done. But you get into that 4 range, 5 range, 6 range, and you're talking about maybe several seconds or more worth of shaking. And if it's going for several seconds, you are then looking around and you know you're going to go to a certain spot. Now, you haven't done it yet because it's still slightly shaking. It's not reached that full large earthquake potential. But once you get into that upper 5 to 6 range, you're going to probably be either wanting to take shelter or you might be like one of these people running around screaming earthquake with a camera in your hand. I would suggest running around right to your place where you're going to be protected, your table or desk, have the camera going, and get yourself sliding under there and catching everything falling as you're going in there. That'll be a great shot, and you'll be safe as things are falling. And then if it's a larger earthquake, you are then making your way to the exit. And you've already thought about this, right? You're going to think about this. Which exit are you going to go to? If you're going to a certain exit, is there big furniture or heavy appliances or something nearby the door that can slide in front of the door or fall over in front of it? You do not want to be playing moving furniture guy when the earthquake is going on, right? You don't want to fill that role. So you better not have anything set by the door that can move in front of it, because in large earthquakes, things tend to slide. Heavy things tend to slide. So be ready for that. If you're going outside, one final thing. The entire northern hemisphere right now, Russia, Europe, United States, Canada, all of us, Asia, it's cold outside, right? I mean, there's some of you that are warm. I mean, you get down here into the southern states, the United States, and maybe South Europe, it might be a little toasty still, but it's cold. It's cold. So you might want to think about putting some clothes in that bug out bag, something that'll keep you warm if you have to go outside in the middle of the night or you don't have your jacket, earthquake strikes, right? Just think about those things now. Put them in the bag. Have the bag ready to go. The bag should also have first aid, maybe a form of communication of some kind. If you live in a city, you probably are going to want to have some kind of form of self-defense just because some people are going to be on a rampage taking things when any kind of disaster happens. So think about those things ahead of time. You'll be way, way better off than all the other people who haven't thought about it at all. And don't broadcast this, actually. Let me do the broadcasting here telling you what to do or whatever, or getting a plan together. But when you do your plan, don't go telling everybody about what you got. Don't go bragging it up to your friends and your neighbors. I mean, unless you really love them. Because they're going to be coming to you knowing that you have food, water, first aid, all that stuff. And you'll have enough problems of your own at first. Then you can branch out if you want to help people, right? So think about that too. And don't be scared. Do not be scared by earthquakes anymore. The randomness that you were told about earthquakes, totally false. There is a predictability to earthquakes. We watch pressure transfer across these regions. We watch the West Coast get hit. We watch the Midwest get hit. We know for it to transfer, and we watch for it to happen. It's on a regular basis. That's just in the United States. The West Coast of the U.S., your pressure comes from follow the arrows. Look where the arrows point. You know what I didn't touch on, and I need to touch on really quick? I said I was going to talk about it, and I haven't. Tomorrow night, we're going to have a new forecast out, but this may develop before tomorrow night. This 5.0 struck yesterday up here on the northwest edge of the Craton. Within 72 hours of this 5 hitting, it should push down the interior edge of the Craton, going up into Yellowstone, into Montana, southeast Idaho. Additionally, the fracking operations at the Kansas-Oklahoma border are going to get hit pretty hard this time. This 5 is enough. It's going to be split two ways. It's already gone up to the North Pole, but I also think that it's going to be going down to the south, and I think we're going to be looking at 4.0 activity up at Yellowstone right after Christmas, so within the next day. And then down to the south, we're also looking at 4.0 activity, maybe even 4.5, back at the fracking operations. This 5 is going to lose a little steam. Brute force trying to push its way along the interior edge of the North American Craton. You can see the mountain ranges here marked brown versus light brown. And the dark brown is higher elevation. Light brown is more of a steppes plateau area. And then we get down more to sea level with the green. And you can see it follow the interior edge down. It goes right across Yellowstone, carries on across Colorado, and then makes a hard line over to the east, the perforations from the fracking operations in the Midwest. So 4.0 activity at Yellowstone for Christmas. How about that? For all the Yellowstone YouTube video makers, there's your Christmas present. Get ready for it. You might be able to cash in with your buffalo running out and Yellowstone getting ready to erupt videos on YouTube that everybody loves so much. Nobody likes to hear the real truth. It's not going to erupt. It's just getting pushed. Much more exciting to think that Yellowstone's going to erupt at Christmas time. So just wait for that earthquake to hit and watch them all freak out on YouTube. That'll be great. And we'll be here to correct them all. Don't worry. And finally, one final thing. I would like to wish you a Merry Christmas one more time. You guys go have a good holiday, and I'll be back tomorrow night. And tomorrow night, we are going to be opening a whole bunch of stuff. Look at my Christmas tree here. Do you see the Christmas tree? Let me make it. Whoa. Oh, there. Hold on. Look down below the Christmas tree. See all those packages? Okay, there's a cooler in there. I would assume there's beer or some kind of alcohol in there. We've got all kinds of letters and packs sent from people around the world. And we will be opening those letters and packs tomorrow night. I did a letter opening tonight, Christmas cards and letter opening. It's a video over on my YouTube channel. I would encourage you to go watch it. It's great. Heartfelt thanks from around the world from viewers. You guys are absolutely incredible. Many, many thanks for your kind cards. And if anything else goes down, I'll be back on. We might be getting some more snow tonight here. So it's going to be a white Christmas. We already got snow on the ground, but it's going to be a white Christmas. It looks like snow coming in on the radar, unless they zap it off with the radar and give us a heartbreak and do some weather modification. We're going to get some snow, and I'm excited about that too. I'm excited about you guys all sticking around with me, even though that, well, it's all hit the fan 100,000 times and back. It's been fun. It's been an adventure, I'll tell you. And class. You are now dismissed. Be safe. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, and good night. Truman Show style, I'm going to get my Makoko and drink my Makoko. And I'm going to look around for those cameras because they got to be hidden all around here for everybody to see everything, right? Cue up the Twilight Zone music as I get a little paranoid. Much love, guys. Peace out.